Albert Fish, 1870 to 1936. Edward Budd was an able-bodied, energetic young man, the eldest child of a poor working-class family scraping by in a New York City tenement. In late May 1928, hoping to find summer work as a farmhand, he placed a classified ad in a newspaper, Youth 18 Wishes Position in Country. Several days later, a frail-looking old man with gentle eyes and drooping mustache showed up at the Budd's apartment. Introducing himself as Frank Howard, the little man explained that he was hiring help for his truck farm on Long Island. He had spotted Edward's ad in the paper and had come to interview the young man for a job. Mr. Howard gave Edward the once-over and seemed satisfied by what he saw. He made a generous offer and arranged to return in a few days to pick Edward up and drive him to the farm. A few days later, on Sunday, June 3rd, the old man returned. Edward was out on an errand. Mrs. Budd invited her son's new employer to have lunch with the family while they awaited the young man's return. Shortly afterward, while Mr. Howard sat at the Budd's kitchen table, the youngest member of the family, a glowing little girl named Grace, wandered into the room. She instantly caught the old man's eye. He called her over, sat her on his knee, and exclaimed over her beauty. She reminded him, he said, as he caressed her silky brown hair, of his own 10-year-old granddaughter. Suddenly, he turned to her parents as though an idea had just struck him. His niece, who lived in Upper Manhattan, was having a birthday party that afternoon. He decided to attend the party for a few hours, then pick up Edward afterward. Perhaps Grace would like to come along with him. It was going to be quite a party, with lots of children and games and ice cream. He would take good care of her and bring her home before dark. Mrs. Budd felt a little uncertain about letting her child go off with a virtual stranger. Still, Mr. Howard seemed so utterly harmless that her qualms seemed foolish, and besides, the old gentleman had offered her son a desperately needed job. She allowed herself to be persuaded. Let her go, Grace's father urged. She doesn't see much good times. Grace was gotten up in her prettiest outfit. Then the creature known as Frank Howard, whose name was really Albert Fish, and whose kindly demeanor concealed a mind of unimaginable depravity, took the child by the hand and led her away from home toward a subway station. Before boarding the train, the old man stopped to retrieve a canvas bundle he had stashed behind a corner newsstand on his way to the Budd's apartment. Wrapped inside were a butcher's knife, a cleaver, and a saw. To describe Albert Fish as the black sheep of his family is almost a laughable understatement. No eminent American family has ever been cursed with any sheep blacker. Though his ancestors fought in the Revolutionary War and his namesake had served as Secretary of State in the Grant Administration, Albert Fish, whose given name was actually Hamilton Fish, came from a branch of the family characterized by poverty and psychosis. When he was 5, his parents, unable to afford his upbringing, placed him in a public orphanage. There, Fish had a teacher whose preferred form of discipline was to strip her young charges naked and beat their bare bodies while the other boys and girls watched. Fish came away from the experience with a singular education. What he learned, as he later put it, was to enjoy everything that hurt. At 28, Fish was making an irregular living as a house painter and handyman. He married a 19-year-old woman who would eventually abandon him for another man, leaving Fish to care for their 6 children. He was an affectionate father and grandfather. At the same time, he admitted to other feelings towards children. As he grew older, he became increasingly possessed by what he described as a lust for their blood. Obsessed throughout his life with religion, Fish began to have searing visions of Christ and his angels, and to hear the voice of God addressing him in dark, quasi-biblical terms. Quote, "Blessed is the man who correcteth his son, in whom he delighteth with stripes." Unquote. Quote, "Happy is he that taketh thy little ones and dasheth their head against their stones." Unquote. He saw himself as Abraham and each of his little victims as a young Isaac. "It seemed to me," he later explained, "that I had to offer a child for sacrifice to purge myself of sins, iniquities, and abominations in the sight of God." His compulsion to kill grew overpowering. Even today, no one knows the precise number of victims, though it seems certain that he molested several hundred and slew at least 15. Most were children of the slums. Many of his victims were black, and authorities, after a cursory investigation, simply gave up the search. Eventually, authorities would learn some of the horrifying details from Albert Fish himself. But that wouldn't happen until 6 years after Grace Budd's disappearance. And on June 3, 1928, Grace Budd's parents had no way of knowing any of these facts about the monster who called himself Frank Howard, the friendly old man who led their little daughter onto the New York Central Railroad while, tucked under one arm, he carried the canvas bundle containing the tools he liked to think of as his implements of hell. Over the course of the next 6 years, the New York City Police, led by Detective William King on the Missing Persons Bureau, conducted a massive manhunt for the Budd girl and her kidnapper. Hopes were raised and dashed with dismaying regularity. Then, November 1934, a letter addressed to Grace's mother arrived at the Budd's apartment. Its contents were unspeakably demented. The anonymous writer began by recounting a story he had heard about a famine in China, during which boys and girls under the age of 12 were seized and cut up and their meat sold. The writer explained that he had been told this story by an acquaintance, a sea captain, who had lived in Hong Kong. On Sunday, June 3, 1928, the letter continued, "I called on you at 406 West 15th Street. We had lunch. Grace sat in my lap and kissed me. I made up my mind to eat her. On the pretense of taking her to a party, I took her to an empty house in Westchester. I choked her to death, then cut her in small pieces so I could take her meat to my rooms, cook and eat it. How sweet and tender her little ass was, roasted in the oven." By dint of old-fashioned sleuthing, Detective King managed to trace the letter to its source. A trap was laid and Fish was arrested. His confession stunned even the most hardened officers. Fish revealed that Grace was not his intended victim at all. He had originally planned to kill her brother. His intent was to lure Edward up to the abandoned house in suburban Westchester, overpower him, bind him with stout cords, and slice off his penis. Afterward, he planned to take the train back to the city, leaving the trussed and mutilated boy to bleed to death on the floor of the cottage. The moment he saw little Grace, however, he changed his plan. It was she he wanted to sacrifice, not her brother, and so he made up the birthday party story on the spot. After leading her out of the city to a place known locally as Wisteria Cottage, he left her out in an empty house's front yard picking wildflowers. He then made his way to an upstairs bedroom and stripped completely naked. Concealing himself behind a door, he called to Grace to come upstairs. When she reached the landing, he leapt out at her and strangled her, kneeling on her chest and climaxing twice as she expired. Then he cut her body into pieces and disposed of them in various places around the property, all except for a few pounds of her flesh, which he had carried back into the city with him, wrapped in newspaper. Fish's trial in 1935 held the nation riveted with his steady stream of shocking revelations, including Fish's incredible disclosure that he had used the butchered chunks of the little girl's body to make a human stew, cooking her flesh in a pot with carrots, onions, and strips of bacon, devouring the infernal concoction over a period of about a week. Meanwhile, Fish took a liking to Dr. Frederick Wortham, senior psychiatrist at Bellevue Hospital, who had been retained by the defense to examine the madman. For the first time, Fish opened himself up to another human being, revealing the incredible story of his life and crimes, a history so appalling that years later, after a long career of dealing with the criminally insane, Wortham would continue to regard Fish as the most wildly deranged human being he had ever encountered. Among other incredible admissions, Fish explained that one of his favorite forms of sexual gratification consisted of shoving sewing needles up into his crotch just behind the scrotum. Wortham had difficulty believing this claim until x-rays were taken, which revealed 27 sewing needles lodged around Fish's pelvic region. In the end, Fish was found guilty and sentenced to death. Even the jurors believed he was insane, but as one of them later explained, they felt he should be electrocuted anyway. On Thursday, January 16, 1936, Albert Fish went to the chair, the oldest man ever to be electrocuted at Sing Sing.